thee now, thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget thy thorn-crowned brow, lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thy love, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me like Mary through the gloom come with a gift to thee. Show to me now the empty tomb. Lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee, even thy cup of grief to share. Thou hast borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary.
Let's pray together as we begin our evening. Father God, tonight is the reminder of the reality of the death of the Son of God, who died in our place. He took our sin upon himself, and he bore the guilt and the shame that we deserved because we couldn't do it in order to give ourselves eternal life. Only he was required because he was perfect and sinless. Only he could pay the debt. So we thank you for this reminder tonight as we gather together, as we sing, as we hear scripture, as we worship, as we are reminded from a drama, all of the things that you have done for us on the cross. Thank you for that love for us while we were your enemies. You died for us. And tonight we remember and we worship in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're very honored that you have joined us for this Good Friday service. Have you ever wondered why it's called Good Friday? This doesn't seem like such a good event for the things that took place. It's a very horrible, horrible day. It's a day of terrific, terrific pain and suffering and agony for our Savior. It was an illegal trial, and it was put on by people who were jealous and people who were hateful, but yet they were religious leaders. And so we see this concept of Good Friday, like, what do you mean good? And honestly, we don't really know where Good Friday came from. We've looked at several different areas in commentaries and so forth, but really Oxford English Dictionary really brought it out the best to remind us that it could come from an older language that had to do with sacred or holy. And so Good Friday comes from that. And so today reminds us that the holy standards of God, however, cannot be met by human, not by human effort or human wisdom. God's standards are holy because of our sin. We don't meet those standards, and so we needed God. We all fall short of his glory. And John the Baptist foresaw this holy day when he saw Jesus coming to him. He said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." A young child walked into church with her father, and she saw the cross hanging on the wall, and she says, "Daddy, why is there a big plus sign on the wall?" Well, perhaps that's the way that we should view it also. God added all of Christ's sinlessness to our account and declares us righteous. Amen? So, what is the proper response then for what Jesus has done? For such a wonderful thing. Hymn writers have written many, many songs about it, and perhaps no one better than Isaac Watts. And he said it more eloquently when he brought in, "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died." Why don't we stand as we sing tonight, just to stand and worship before our God, "When I survey the wondrous cross."
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and poor content.
Thank you. You may be seated. This is a fantastic weekend. We have both the crucifixion that we're reminded of, and then on Sunday, the resurrection. Tonight, we're going to focus on the cross. Not that we don't believe in the resurrection. We certainly do, and we invite you to come on Sunday if you don't have a place to go and be reminded with us about the resurrection of our Savior. But for right now, we're going to talk about the cross, and we're going to talk about the mercy and all of the grace that comes with the love of God that he has given to us that we don't deserve. And while we are his enemies, it says in Romans, he died for us. God loved us so much that he sent his son into the world that whoever believes in him will be saved. And so he loves us and he cares for us. And now we're going to talk and sing about the power of the cross. It's not just symbolic. It's a real thing that brings power to those who believe.
Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful man, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin. Every bitter thought, every evil deed, crowning your blood-stained brow. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Now the daylight flees, now the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Curtain torn in two, dead or raised to life, finish the victory cry. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see my name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, life is mine to live, won through your selfless love. This the power of the
For those of you who are not familiar with some contemporary songs, there's one that Chris Tomlin does called At the Cross. I know it's familiar as a traditional hymn, but he does, it's called Love Ran Red at the Cross. And so we're going to sing that tonight. Some of you may know it, some may not, but feel free to join in if you pick up on the song. It has great words, there's a great theme behind it, so go ahead and sing with us.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus. There is a place where sin and shame are powerless. Where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. Here my hope is found, here on holy ground, here I bow down, here I bow down, here arms open wide, here you save my life, here I bow down, here I bow. At the cross, I surrender my life, I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you. At the cross, I surrender my life, I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, 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 Jesus. Your
thank you.
him away, to crucify him. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You, who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself.
Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him.
"He saved others, but he can't save himself.
He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him."
"He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'"
In the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. From noon until 3 p.m, darkness came over all the land. About 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
"My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of those standing there heard this, they said,
"He's calling Elijah."
Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said,
"Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him."
And when Jesus cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rock split, and the tombs broke open.
I'll ask you again, who were you? Or maybe I should be asking myself, Claudius, who are you, a centurion talking thusly to a corpse? A corpse. The body of a dead man, that's it. Men die, you die. You are a man, that's all you were, all you ever would be. I've answered my own question now, haven't I? But I've never seen a man die like you. And I've seen a lot of men die. I've been part of the crucifixion of many of them. And I've listened as they grovel in the dirt and say, "Oh, centurion, centurion, have mercy on me. I am an innocent man. If you kill me, you will be killing an innocent." Liars, all of them. And if they cannot persuade me with their lies, I become the recipient of some of the most vile things that could come out of the mouth of a human being. And sometimes what comes out of their mouth, I have to
wipe away. Disgusting. But you, you neither cursed me nor spat upon me. And don't think I did not hear you as you were hanging there between earth and the sky. Oh, I don't suppose the others heard you at all. They were too busy arguing and casting lots for your garments. But I heard it. I heard it, but I couldn't believe it. Father? Forgive them? They do not know what they are doing? What manner of man forgives his torturers? But that was last Friday. Things have greatly changed. Permit me to introduce myself. I'm Claudius Longinus, a centurion of Rome, 5th Division. And I was on duty last Friday. I volunteered for it myself. It always helps get a few points with those who are above you, you know. By the time the Nazarene had arrived at Calvary, he was almost half dead. I could even see through his back some of his inner organs. It's a horrible thing. Why did they have so much hate for him? I couldn't figure it out. And when the soldiers pushed him to the ground and stretched out his arms for me, he winced in pain like any man would. But the look in his eyes, I shall never be able to forget it as long as I shall live. It was not the look of hatred that I was so used to seeing. It was, well, what should I call it? It was not fear. It was a look of pity. But not pity for himself. Pity for me. As I was raising the hammer to bring it across those nails that would pierce his body and begin his agony, that look in his eyes and those words, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. I almost laughed at that one. I knew what I was doing. I'm actually quite good at it. Crucifixion. Did you know, for example, that there are actually two forms of crucifixion? Yes, I can show you. There is, first of all, the ropes crucifixion. There is also the nails crucifixion. A ropes crucifixion was exactly what you would think it would be. You simply tie a man stark naked to the cross and leave him there, exposed to all of the elements and without anything to drink. They die of thirst and exposure. Just hanging in the noonday sun for a couple of hours is enough to kill some men. But the more robust could last for, like I say, sometimes 2-3 days at the most. Ropes with nails. It's much quicker and a whole lot messier, I can assure you. Last Friday was a nails crucifixion. had to be quicker because of the Jewish holy day that was coming up. Holy day. Oh, the Jews and their holy days. What a bunch of hypocrites most of them were. Anyway, back to the nails. You know, most people think that the nails go through this part of the palm. But it doesn't work that way at all. I mean, think about it. If I were to nail these nails through a man's hand and then pull him up and cause the cross to fall into the hole which was prepared for it, his weight would simply pull through the flesh and he would fall to the ground. Whoops, little bit of a problem there now, don't we? No. The nails go right here. See, you've got to be careful to put them here. Those two bones will hold the body up quite nicely, but you have to know it takes more expertise than you think. You see, you've got to be careful that you do not hit the artery. If you were to hit the artery, then that victim would die in a matter of moments. No, that is not what crucifixion is for. That's not its purpose at all. It is slow death, agonizing pain. The Phoenicians started it all. I suspect that it is the Romans that have perfected it, as I say. But it does take a lot of precision, like I say. You know, I think in all of the years I have participated in crucifixions, I have only hit the artery one time. Oh my, I was the laughing stock of the Roman cohort that afternoon. I made sure it never happened again. But you know, I've always been amazed. Amazed at how a man can survive the torture. The torture of a crucifixion. I mean, with the flogging that literally tears off a man's back and carrying the cross piece, which we call the patibulum, carrying that up the road to Golgotha. I don't know how some of them survive it. They are usually half dead by the time they get there. But the real torture comes when they are nailed to the wood and that wooden piece is dropped into the hole and they are lifted into the air. I mean, you're hanging with outstretched arms, and all the weight of your body is concentrated on the pectoral muscles of the chest, and I've watched them long enough to know it only takes about a minute and they cannot breathe. The muscles spasm and the man cannot breathe, and so in order to get a breath, he has to push himself up on his feet that have been nailed to the little wooden step at the bottom of the cross. And I suspect, because I've watched them, that pain must be unimaginable. And when that pain becomes too unbearable, once again, the body drops. And all the weight again, putting pressure on the chest muscles. And it continues on and on and on. That's crucifixion for you. You know, we Romans say, if you don't want to bear the pain, don't do the crime. It's justice. And I have never felt the least bit of sorrow, of personal pain in carrying out the sentence on those who deserved it. And I can tell you for certain that it does greatly affect the crime rate. I mean, think about it. You don't have any repeat offenders now, do you? Not at all. Like I say, it never bothered me before. As an executioner, I am protecting the good citizens of the Roman Empire. The crucifixion of the Nazarene. It bothered me greatly. I wasn't able to sleep for days. When I would drift off, I would see his eyes peering into mine and hear those words, "Father, forgive them." You may wonder why my response to this crucifixion was different than the others. I don't suppose you really want to hear all of the story, but I will tell you that I had some inside information from a Jewish woman named Miriam. No, it was not like you are thinking. It was not some sort of romantic liaison with that woman, no. Although I will tell you that many of the Roman soldiers often took advantage of the woman. This woman was very old. Her name was Miriam. She reminded me of my grandmother who passed some years ago. Miriam would hang around the stables and caring for the horses and feeding and washing them and, well, to be honest, caring for us soldiers. She did not have to do it. In fact, she did it only from the kindness of her heart when most Jewish people hated us as much as they could possibly hate us. Miriam treated us as though we were her own sons. One day I asked her, I said, "Miriam, answer a question for me." Of course, I guess as I was wiping my sword, she probably thought she had to. Why is it that you are doing these things? She simply replied, "I try to show the love of Yahweh, the one true God." We got into a bit of a tiff on that one. "Miriam, there are many gods," I protested, "not just one." "And how is it that you know these things, Claudius? These so-called gods I see you worship are just as human as you are. What about your emperor? You call him a god, and yet recently you told me that you had heard he was quite ill. Now tell me, how does one who is a god get ill?" I could not answer her question. But I followed with a question of my own. "Miriam, this God of yours, whom you say made heaven and earth, if he is so powerful, why does he allow you to be enslaved by people like me?" I thought I had her on that one. "Why does he force you to keep bringing bloody sacrifices to him? It seems to me that such a bloody religion is worthless. She looked like she was about to cry. I thought I had her on that one. But then she said, "That's very easy to answer, Claudius. We Jews have been a wicked people. Rather than turning to our one true God who made us and provides for us, my people have broken his laws and turned to the false gods you worship. But Yahweh, our one true God, has promised to send the Yeshua HaMashiach, the Redeemer. He has promised to redeem us. Those bloody sacrifices, you see, are just a reminder that someday God will send that Savior, the true Lamb of God, who will suffer and die for our sins and pay for it all once and final." "The prophet wrote," she said, "he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." Now listen to what else the prophet said, Claudius. "All we like sheep have gone astray." You've seen it happen with sheep. "We've turned every one to his own way, but the Lord has laid upon him, the Redeemer, the Lamb of God, the iniquity of us all." I don't know how long our little religious discussions persisted, but one day, completely out of the blue, she surprised me. Grabbing me by the shoulders, she said, "Claudius, the Yeshua HaMashiach has come. He has come to save us. He will redeem us finally." And then she proceeded to tell me about a Jewish carpenter, the Nazarene, one who was claiming to be the Messiah. I was not impressed. "Miriam, you know yourself that there have been many who claim to be the Messiah. But Claudius, what the others could never do, this man does. He touches the eyes of the blind and they can see. He causes the lame to walk. He heals the sick, and just last week in Bethany, perhaps you heard of it, he raised a man from the dead, a man who had been dead for 3 days. She was so excited that I did not have any desire to argue with her or stifle the joy that had overcome her. But that's when I too began to hear the reports of a Nazarene, reports of a Jewish carpenter. Just a few days ago, there was a huge turmoil when he rode into the city of Jerusalem claiming to be the Yeshua HaMashiach. I heard, and you can imagine my surprise when I was called to stand guard as Pilate spoke to the religious leaders of the Jews. They had brought before him a man, that same man, that same Nazarene, who was accused of blasphemy. He called himself the Son of God. And then I saw him, the Nazarene, not an impressive representation of a man who claimed to be God. Pilate examined him. He examined him publicly and concluded, I find no fault with this man. I sent him also to be examined by Herod, and he finds no fault in him either. That was the official verdict. I find no fault in this man. Not guilty. I will release him. And that should have ended the matter. But now Pilate found himself in a political dilemma. He tried to get out of it by offering the traditional release of a prisoner at Passover. Barabbas was a noted prisoner. He was a thief, a murderer. Pilate saw it as a proposition that could not fail in his mind. There was not a chance the Jews would want such a wicked man on their streets again. But he was wrong. Whom shall I release to you? Barabbas or Jesus? He was shocked by their response. You could see it clearly on his face when they yelled, Barabbas. What should I do with Jesus? And in a demonic roar that filled and echoed through that outdoor assembly, they shouted, crucify him! Why? What evil has he done? But he could see that the gathering was about to turn into a dangerous riot, and Pilate said, I find no fault in this man. I wash my hands of the blood of this man. And they screamed, his blood be upon us and upon our children.
I find no fault in him. I find no fault in him. Yet he was rejected, despised of men. But I find no fault in him. They led Christ to Calvary, and he spoke not one word. Just the cries of lost sinners was all my Savior heard. And then they pierced him so deep in his side until the blood came streaming down. And that's how Jesus purchased my salvation. And I find no fault in him. I find no fault
He was rejected, despised of men, but I find no fault in him. Oh, he was rejected, despised.
Intelligent man to realize that Jesus was completely innocent of the charges. Why, they couldn't even get their facts together. They all said something different. They couldn't agree. And I could not believe what my ears were hearing. Pilate handed Jesus over to the people to be crucified. I wanted to shout at the governor myself, "You can't do that. You can't do that. It is unjust and unfair." But I said nothing. I did not understand why Miriam's God, who would allow the death of an innocent man. And then, the words she had repeated from the Old Testament prophet gripped my soul. A lamb to die for the sins of the people. What was it she had said? All of us, all we, like sheep, have wandered. We've gone astray. Something about God laying those sins on him, and this was the Passover when a lamb was to die, but this would be the Lamb of God. And I was beginning to understand everything she had said to me.
It was Friday, and Pilate washed his hands of the blood of Jesus. The crowd cried, "Crucify the King of the Jews, give us Barabbas." But that was Friday. Sunday's coming. It was Friday. We led the Lord with a heavy cross to the top of Calvary. We nailed his hands and his feet, and he hung in bitter agony. That was Friday. Sunday's coming. And on Friday, as the Savior bled, his men all turned away and fled. The multitudes mocked as the crowd passed by. Mary bowed her head and cried. The demons of hell all cheered his death as Jesus breathed his final breath. But that was Friday. Sunday's coming. It was Friday. They laid his body in a borrowed grave, and they departed. Their king was dead, and they were also brokenhearted. But that was Friday. Sunday's coming. Yes, that was Friday. Sunday's coming. Then Sunday came, and the curse of death was broken. Hell tried in vain, but the tomb was ripped wide open. He is not here, there's no more need for fear. Make the message loud and clear, Jesus is alive. Oh, death, where is your victory? And grave, where is your sting? Our Lord has fought and won the victory. He's alive, our risen King. When Sunday came, the tomb was ripped wide open. Hell tried in vain, but the curse of death was broken. He is not here, there's no more need for fear. Make the message loud and clear, Jesus is alive. He's alive, he's alive. Jesus is alive.
Alive. What happened? 3 days after the crucifixion changed everything. But I did not need the events of Sunday to convince me of the decision I made on Friday. His words convinced me. Father, forgive them, they do not know what they are doing. What manner of man speaks words like that? His actions convinced me. We gave him some wine mixed with gall. It was to help dull his senses and some of the pain, but he absolutely refused it. I said to myself, this man really believes he is dying for the sin of the world, and he wants to be keenly aware of all of the pain of our wickedness. The entire process of that crucifixion was getting to me. Never before had I felt such fear, fear in my bones. You heard me correctly. It was fear. I was an honored centurion, one of Rome's finest and bravest, but I was terrified. And then it happened about the sixth hour. There was the sound of a rumble beneath my feet, almost as though the earth itself were beginning to groan. And even though the sun was at its zenith in the overhead sky, I could sense a darkness settling upon us, enveloping that hill. I can't really say if it was clouds or not, but it was a darkness that was covering like an eerie blanket of evil. It was like a spiritual battle was taking place. And in the midst of my fear and the darkness and the rumbling of the earth, everything seemed to be happening in rapid succession. Jesus screamed, or maybe maybe it wasn't a scream. It was a combination of a horrific, sorrowful crying and almost like the roar of a lion pouncing on his prey. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And then, Tetelestai. It is finished. It is paid in full. What ordinary man speaks words like those when he is dying? Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. That's when the rumble began to shake the rocks from their places in Golgotha. I could sense the fear in the hearts of all of those gathered there, but at that moment I cared nothing of them. I felt myself naked in the presence of Almighty God. Before me was an innocent man dying for my sin. And I felt as though I was standing on the witness stand of all the universe with God staring at me. What would my witness be? What was it that my eyes had seen? And I swore to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me, God. And I will tell you tonight what I said then. Surely this was the Son of God.
I just really appreciate the fact that he wore shorts under that. Good thing it wasn't a Scottish kilt, we'd be in trouble. So here's our idea for tonight, is you just saw on the screen and it went away. Sin, that's the whole reason Jesus died. Sin, it seems like a word everybody knows, but not everybody thinks that they're a sinner. Well, the Bible very clearly tells us that sin affects each and every one of us. And to understand the good news of how the relationship between God and man must be restored, you have to first understand how we fell into this position anyway. We're all sinners, and the Word teaches us that. All have sinned. How many have? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's each and every one of us, past, present, and future, who were born into this world. The Bible says that we are all dead in our trespasses and our sins in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5. Just think about it like this. You have a man who is clean. He's out hunting, and he runs into an already decaying, dying animal. He doesn't want to go near it. It's disgusting. There's flies and maggots, and it's gross, and it's not something worth going around or being near or even picking up and taking home and trying to make clean, because it's just disgusting. And God is holy. He is spiritually clean, and man is sinful, spiritually unclean. Just as a person who is physically clean would not tolerate being next to this dead animal, decaying, stinking as it is, so a perfect and holy God cannot allow sin and imperfection into heaven. And so God had a plan, because we couldn't do that. Yet sin had separated man from God, and sin separates us from God on a day-to-day basis, and the result of sin is clear. The Bible says in Isaiah 59:2, your sins have made a barrier between you and your God. Man's sin has done that, and so as pictured in this scene, like a wall, a barrier that separates man from God, God's holiness, spiritual cleanness, and our sinful uncleanness has separated us from God. And so many people try in so many different ways to break down this barrier, whether they think baptism will do it, or if I just love my neighbor, or maybe if I follow the sacraments of the church, or what if I obey the Ten Commandments and I just do my best, I just try, And maybe if I go to church on Christmas and Easter, God will be happy with me. People try everything they can to break down that barrier, to go around what God has done, because God has already done it. But the Bible says we are all like an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. All of the things that we attempt to do to break down the barricade are not worthy. They can't do it. It's impossible. To attempt to wash away your sins through your own works is as hopeless as trying to wash a dirty face using a dirty, greasy rag. There's absolutely nothing that man can do to erase his sins and cross the barrier on his own that separates him from God. So here we have the gospel. This is the word we use in the church, and it's a common word everywhere we go. The gospel means good news. That is, since we can never come into the presence, into God's presence with our sin, God sent Jesus to die for our sins. And that's what we're talking about tonight with the cross and the centurion. But he raised him from the dead also. He didn't stay dead. On the third day, he rose again, and we'll be celebrating that this Sunday. He says in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, that is, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried," because he was dead, "and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures." This isn't our opinion, by the way. This is straight from the Bible. This is not just Apostle Paul writing here saying, here's what I think. No, Apostle Paul is even referring to the Scriptures, which are God's words. And so God has told us how he did it. He died on the cross, and he rose from the dead, and he broke down that barrier that divides us from our holy God. And so because Jesus Christ did it, we can be saved. Because Jesus Christ stood in our place and died in our place, we can put our trust in him and his death and his resurrection and have eternal life. Jesus tore down the barrier of sin by dying for our sins and raising from the dead. Now, many people believe that Jesus died and rose again from the dead, but what does the Bible mean when it says that Jesus died for our sins? And how did his death tear down the barrier between God and man? So here's the problem. God has to punish sin. All sin is punished. And the penalty for sin, the Bible says, is death. So God has to punish sin, and he does it through death. And God punishes those who bear the sin guilt. Now, when Jesus died on the cross, he took that sin guilt upon himself. The Bible tells us that since God is holy and just, he must punish those who bear the guilt of sin. It says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 6, "Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things comes the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience." Romans 1, verse 18 says that the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of man. And so the wrath of God must fall on those who bear the guilt of sin. And the Bible says we are all guilty. We have all sinned, and God says the penalty for sin is death. And so we are people, humans, who fall under that guilt. God's justice requires that those who bear the guilt of sin must suffer God's just punishment. Several references to this, but we're going to move on. And says how Christ freed us from God's wrath through his own death can be explained in three simple steps. Okay, first of all, it's called imputed guilt. Christ took our sin upon himself by legal declaration. It is a declaration of what Christ has done, and he declares us righteous. The first step in the redemption of mankind for Jesus Christ to bear the sins of the world in his body on the cross. When Jesus hung on the cross, God took all of the sins of the world, past, present, and future, and placed them or imputed them upon Christ. The Bible says, "And the Lord has laid on him," that's Jesus, "the iniquity," or the sin, "of us all," Isaiah 53. He his own self bore our sins in his body on the tree, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. "For he," that's God the Father, "made him," that's Jesus, "who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." So in the court of heaven, Jesus was declared guilty of the sins of the world. It was imputed onto him. He took the sin, and so God says he has the guilt. How can Jesus' death be so valuable that it can pay not only for all of our sins, but for all the sins of all men for all time. Step two then talks about the substitution, that Christ died in our place. He stood for us when we should have taken the penalty. And since God must punish sin, those who bear the sin guilt, he poured out his wrath upon Jesus in our place. Jesus became our substitute. He was punished for our sin and died in our place. Amen? Amen. So the Bible says that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And it says in Matthew 27, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? He had the guilt and he needed to bear the punishment. God punished his own son, Jesus, in our place. So if we put our trust in Jesus Christ, we receive that righteousness of God and we are guilt-free. The third step, redemption and satisfaction. Christ's death paid in full for our sins and thereby satisfying God's anger and justice. It's satisfied. We have a word called propitiation, which means it was the satisfaction. God was satisfied concerning our sins because of Jesus' death on the cross. And since Jesus died in our place for our sins, God's justice was satisfied. Jesus paid for all of man's sin. So many who choose to accept that payment will never have to experience the eternal wrath of God, which must come upon all of man's sins. So here's what the Bible says, that it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He had put him to grief. When thou, that's God the Father, shall make his, that's Jesus, soul an offering for sin, he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. The things that God allowed Jesus to go through brought satisfaction for our sins. And so when Jesus therefore received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Pastor Joe mentioned that tonight. Our centurion friend mentioned that tonight. The phrase, it is finished, as he said, was actually an expression used in Rome in the time of Christ when a debt had been paid in full. And when Jesus shouted this just before he died, he was indicating that he had made a perfect, complete, and final payment for sin. We do not have to pay because Christ has paid in full. The account for our sins is paid in full. How do you receive the payment? Yes, Jesus died for the sins of the world, but only those who put their trust in him will benefit from it. You have an opportunity to put your trust in what Jesus did on the cross. Many, many people try their own ways to work their way to heaven, but it doesn't work because all of our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. We put our trust in his death and his resurrection. Not just the knowledge of Jesus, not just the knowledge of his death. We put our trust in those things that he did on the cross, that what his body went through and the suffering that he endured to pay the penalty for our sin. And when we put our trust in him, we'll have eternal life. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads right now. Good Friday. Let's make it not just Good Friday. Let's make it best Friday ever. You will put your trust in Jesus Christ tonight. Before the night's over, you've heard the story for years. You may have been familiar with many different versions, whatever it may be, but the Bible is very clear that Christ died for your sins. And if you put your trust in him, the Bible says that you will have everlasting life. It's permanent. It's done. Everlasting is everlasting. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I'm going to give you a chance just in your seat just to pray right there and say, Jesus, I understand. I'm a sinner, and I also understand that you paid for my sin. I receive that gift of your salvation freely. I put my trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. And it's really that simple as far as salvation goes. Discipleship's a different matter. We can talk about that other days. But your salvation is through Jesus and Jesus alone. Not by your works, not by your efforts. It's by his sweat. His sweat and his blood and not our efforts. He did it all on the cross. And praise God for that. Amen? Amen. If you put your trust in Jesus tonight, welcome to the family of God. If you're a believer in here, we sang some songs that talked about all to him I owe. We don't owe anything as far as our salvation. But he is worthy of our praise and worthy of our honor and our gratitude. And we should live our lives out that way. Let our light shine before men, that they would see our good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. Believers, let's live for Jesus Christ. New believers, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Learn about him. Learn how to honor him. Be a part of the family of God. And let's worship him together until he comes. Let's have a word of prayer and then we'll sing a song. Father God, thank you for allowing us to be reminded of this, to know that this event took place, because we weren't there. And we had to have the information, and you allowed men to write it down and share it with us so that we would know that we can have eternal life. You even said, these are written that you may know that you have eternal life. And so because you've told us and because you died for us and you forgave our sins and we put our trust in you, we know we have eternal life. Thank you for loving us and giving us that opportunity and not abandoning us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. Final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, his perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeat. Love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorified. Forever he is lifted high.
We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. The Lamb has overcome. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. The Lamb has overcome. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. The Lamb has overcome. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. The Lamb has overcome. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. The Lamb has overcome. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. We sing alleluia. The Lamb has overcome. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is as Lord. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive.
Well, it is Friday. Sunday's coming. Jesus rose from the dead, and we'll celebrate that. That's right. Amen. So thanks for coming tonight. We're honored that you're here. God bless you. We hope to see you Sunday. If you don't have a place to be, come worship with us. Your times are on the back of your bulletin. Thanks. God bless. Bye-bye.